So, hello. First of all, these results were, I got them in the research visit to University College London, which was supported by CEU. So this is acknowledgement. I am beholden to Central European University to grant this research visit, as well as also I am thankful for Department of Computer Science at UCL for paying my tuition fees. Also, all the thanks are due to Professor Robin Hirsch for welcoming this visit and support my application. Also, I would like to thank Professors Robin Hirsch and Miklos Sabos for teaching me the theory of relational algebras and for discussing the new results and their proofs. And finally, of course, I would like to express my appreciation to my supervisors, Professors Heiner and Reka and Ishivan Nimetti, for suggesting this problem to me and for introducing me to the English School of the Experts in Relational Algebra Theory. Let's start. So, I mentioned relational algebra theory. So what's relation? Of course, all of you know. Let U be a set, and let N be a number bigger than or equal to 1. Then an N array relation is just a subset of N to U, and power set of UN is the set of all N array relations on U. And then there is a funny example. I copied it from some presentation of Professors Robin Hirsch and Ian Hodkinson. I would like also to give it. So for example, define let X be the set of all people and define XY sum if and only if Y is a sum of X. And same we can define daughter. So XY is in daughter if and only if Y is a daughter of X. So we can define child to be son union daughter. Right? And we can define grandson to be parent, to be child, sorry, composed with son. So grandson is a son for child. And we can define parent to be child converse. This is the converse of a relation. And we can define maybe aunt to be parent, sister. Okay, of course, we should define sister, which is a parent daughter, which is not myself, right? And finally, yeah, my sister is not myself. And mother can be defined to be a parent who has parent, and she is his daughter. And this daughter is the same. Right? What? What? Who doesn't have a mother? Yeah, except the exception cases. Assuming that you have. So, yeah. George Boole, he started the algebraic formalization of unary relations. Unary relation, when n equals 1, this is unary relation. And George Boole started the algebraic formalization of unary relation, and he considered the class of full Boolean set algebras. An algebra is said to be full Boolean set algebra if and only if it is of this form, power set of some u, with intersection, union, complementation, and phi, and u itself. This is the class of full Boolean set algebras. So you take all unary relations on a set u, with intersection between relations, with union, with complement with respect to u, relative complement with respect to u, phi itself is a relation, u itself is a relation, right? And then the representable empty set.
Okay. Empty set.
Yeah, the empty set. The class of representable Boolean set algebras just takes the isomorphic copies of the subalgebras of the products of the full Boolean set algebras. Of course, okay, I'm guessing that you are all familiar with the product. You are all familiar with subalgebras and isomorphic copies. Roughly speaking, you all studied group theory, right? So you all know what is the product of some groups, subgroup, isomorphism between groups, right? This is just generalization of these notions for any algebra. And then Poole himself defined the class of Boolean algebra. So here A is an abstract Boolean algebra if and only if A has the following similarity type. It's A with dot, with plus or, it's and, and or, and negation, and 0, and 1. Those are the Boolean algebras, such that it satisfies some axioms. First axiom that and or are associative, and or are commutative, right? Distributivity between and or, and what else? Absorption law. Absorption laws. What else? Remind me. So zero is the identity of or, and one is the identity of and. And finally, that negation A is the complement of A in this sense. So, okay. And then Stone, this is the famous theorem for Stone. Stone proved that the class of Boolean, the abstract Boolean algebras is the same, is equal to the class of representable Boolean algebras, which means that, of course, any representable Boolean algebras satisfying these axioms, and any algebra satisfying this axiom is an isomorphic to some algebra here. Is it okay? And then, Mr. De Morgan started to consider the binary relations, or higher arity relations. And then he introduced the class of F full relation set algebras. A class of full set relation algebra. Full set relation algebra, if it is of this form. So it's power set. Now we are talking about the binary relations, right? So we have to speak about U cross U, right? And then again, intersection, again union, again complementation with respect to U square, right? And then what else can we consider about binary relations? Composition, right? Converse, right? And of course, phi, and U square itself, and the identity of over U, right? You know the composition between relations, right? I don't need to define it. And do you know the converse of any relation? I don't need to define it, right? So this algebra is called a full relation set algebra, and the FRA is the class of all full relation set algebras. And then the representable relation algebras is defined the same analog. The isomorphic copies of the subalgebras of the products, right, of full relation set algebras. And then the question was, can we axiomatize this class and put some abstract class like Boolean algebra, which have this similarity type, and to get a theorem like Stone's theorem? Mr. Persey and Schroeder, if I'm pronouncing their names correctly, established many properties of binary relations. Then they started to put some equations between relations and to prove that they are correct for any relations. Persey noted that the class of representable relation algebras cannot be subjected to hard and fast rules like those of Boolean algebras. So roughly speaking, he said that I can't axiomatize this class. And then Mr. Tarski, I guess in 1940, He proposed an axiomatization for a large part of the representable relation algebras. And after decades, this axiomatization led to the theory of relation algebras. So we need to define what does it mean, a relation algebra, right? So relation algebra is just an abstraction of the representable relation algebra. So a relation algebra is A, has the same similarity type, okay, and, or, negation, composition, 0, 1, and the identity, okay? Such that it satisfies some axioms. First axiom, I guess, okay, so the Boolean reduct should be Boolean algebra. Those are the set of axioms which axiomatize the Boolean algebras. Second, X or Y composed with Z is X composed with Z or X, Y times Z. Monotonicity. And again, monotonicity. Because in Boolean algebras, we can define a relation. And X composed with the identity will give you again X, right? And the X converse converse is again X. I think I missed some other ones. Yeah, of course, transitivity. And this is a stupid equation. Negation with my new, okay, less than or equal to negation y. Of course, this is equation because this order is defined by equations. So this can be written in a form of equation. So Mr. Tarski proposed some axioms, and then those axioms led after decades to defining the class of relation algebras, as we see. And then it's very easy to see that any representable relation algebra satisfies these axioms. It's very easy, because it's really easy. And then Lendon proved that RA is not RRA, which means that not every class which satisfies this, not every algebra which satisfies these axioms will be isomorphic to a representable relation algebra. And then, moreover, Mr. Monk proved that this class RRA is not finitely axiomatizable. Finitely axiomatizable, it means that you cannot write a finite set of equations which give complete description of this class. Like groups, for example, we write some four or five, whatever, equations, right, to define the group. RRA, we cannot do it with finitely many equations. Yeah. So this is relation algebras. What is arrow logic, which was the title of my talk? As it is written there, arrow logic is designed to talk about all such objects which may be represented in a picture by arrows, right? So, let W be a set of arrows, and then arrow logic is designed to speak about W, right? What the relation can be, my English is very good. What the relations which can be between arrows? First, something like composition, right? If this is B and this is C, then there is an arrow A, or if there is an arrow A here, this means that A is related to B and C via capital C, right? So we may need to speak about C, and C is subset of W cross W cross W, right? And then we can speak about the identity arrow, right? Identity arrow, which means that it starts from a point to the same point, right? So we need to add I, and I is just a set of R's, right? And also, if there is an arrow between A and B, I mean from this point to this point, and B is an arrow, the converse, from this point to this point, so we need an R to speak about such arrows, that they are converse to each other. So we need R, such that R all of them, this is relation structure. All of them are relations. Such a quadruple, we call it Fram structure. Fram, R of Fram, I'm sorry. So an R of Fram is such a quadruple with, okay? And then the class of all R of Frams is denoted by SQ, okay? Nice. What is the relation between this and between relation algebras? Still, this is not relation algebras. Okay. A nice observation by Professor Miklos. What's your family name? Appert. By Professor Appert, that this is a relational structure, right? It is just a set with some relations on this set, right? So, if I have a relational structure, call it F. Such, of course, any relation is n plus 1 arity, with n is in omega, then let Ri be n plus 1 ary relation. Define F from n omega. Yeah. Uh-huh. That's not correct. Yeah. So if I have n plus 1 array relation, I can define an operator which will be just n array operator in this in the following form, or as following. Such is that x0 and x1 and xn are all related with this relation, and xi's are in xi. So, relation. Yeah. No, x0 is, so roughly speaking, it's something like this. That's good. So, if I have, for example, a relation like this, and then I want to define an operator, I can define an operator which takes x to y, or y to x, or whatever. Right? That's all. So, if you return back to SQ, and then I need to make some notation. So, if F is an R of Fram, CMF is the complex algebra defined in this way. Okay, for every R of Fram, if you have an R of Fram, which is of this form, define an algebra, such that the operators are defined in this way. It's okay. And if you have a class K of R of Frams, then CMK is defined to be CMF So if you noticed here, define S Q phi. In fact, this was bad notation, so let me call it AF. The class of all aeroframes is denoted by AF, and then define S Q to be all of those aeroframes such that this aeroframe should be of the form W and C and R and I. It will be in SQ if this W is U cross U for some set, because an arrow can be a relation, can be a tuple between the beginning and the end. So any arrow can be considered as a tuple, right? So if W, if the arrows are tuples, and C is a composition, so C, A, B, C, if and only if this is A, this is B, this is C, so if and only if A0 equals B0 and A1 equals C1 and B1 equals C0, right? And IA, if and only if A0 is A1 and R, AB, if and only if A0 is B1 and B or A1 is B0. Okay? And we call such an aeroframe two-dimensional aeroframe. If we take now this SQ and we make the complex algebras with those aeroframes, what will we get? So let's see what will we get. So our W will be a U cross U, right? And our operators will be defined from power set of W, right, n times. But this C is W cross W cross W, right? So it is three array operation, right? So the operation which will be corresponding to this relation will be two array, right? From power set of W cross power set of W to cross to power set of W, right? And it will be defined in this way, right? So f of x will be, I mean, it will be the composition. The operation which will be corresponding to C will be the composition, right? Hello? Right? W here is, and of course I can compose anything now. I don't speak about A, B, and C, D. I'm just speaking about this. So, isn't it the composition? Right? And the same for the converse? It can be empty set, right? And the same, I will give me the identity, and the R will give me the converse, right? Which means that if we make this complex algebras of those aeroframes, we will get full relation set algebras, right? Right? Nice. Okay. So, we said that the complex algebras of SQ will be FRA. Let's define what is arrow logic. First of all, I want to define what is logic. A logic is quadruple F probability relation, right? A modal and validity relation. course, I'm not going to give you the first course in mathematical logic. Just I'm defining what does it mean, logic. So if I want to know the logic, I need just to know the formulas. I need to know the model. I need to know how to deduce a formula from another formula, right? And I need to know what does it mean, a valid formula, right? And then a logic, L, is called sound. Of course, we know this. If any valid formula is provable, yes? And it's called complete if any valid formula is provable. This is provable, this is valid. This is valid, this is provable. And it is called strongly sound if for any for any sigma subset of formulas, if sigma proves phi, then any model which validates sigma should validate phi. And the strongly complete is analog if for any model, if there exists sigma, if any model for all sigma, if for any model validate sigma is validating phi, then from sigma I can prove phi. It's okay. Nice. I guess that this is the most interesting part of the talk, right? Okay, and then a logic L is said to be decidable if there exists an effective method, just understand it like it is effective method, to determine for every formula whether phi is provable or not. This is decidability. Decidability, it means that if I can decide, if for any formula I can decide whether it is provable or not, whether it is a theorem or not, right? And then what is Godel incompleteness property? So Godel incompleteness property, it's for any phi and for any recursive extension of phi, there exists Psi in K, such that K, well, no, there exists Psi in F, such that K cannot prove Psi and cannot prove negation Psi. Right? If I have a formula, any recursive extension to this formula is incomplete. What does it mean, incomplete? It means that it cannot prove anything, right? So it cannot there exists a psi, that it cannot prove it, and it cannot prove its negation, which means that it is incomplete, right? And weak incomplete, if instead of saying for any recursive extension, I say for any finite recursive extension. Is it okay? No? Okay, yes, no? Recursive extension. Recursive consistent extension of phi, this is Godel incompleteness property. If I said finite recursive extension, then this is weak Godel incompleteness property. Nothing. Okay? Well, this is what I proved about our logic, but it's not important. So, if I want to define the arrow logic, if I... Yeah? Recursive extension? Yeah. Okay, okay, so not any extension. I mean, I want a consistent... So I want a consistent extension. Consistent extension, which means that I cannot find phi and negation phi in this extension. Consistent, it means that K cannot prove.
Exactly.
So I cannot prove a formula and I cannot prove its negation at the same time. Recursive extension, it means that it is extension which is recursively innumerable. I'm sorry. That it is recursively innumerable. This is hard to define, recursively innumerable, but just so you can think that it is innumerable with what's called recursive functions. Is it okay? Is it now okay? So this is a recursive extension. A recursive extension, which is an extension from which you cannot prove a contradiction, and it is innumerable, but not just with any one-to-one correspondence with a recursive functions. Yeah, well, I don't know. Okay, so the example which I know, I tell you something. So assume, okay, so we know that what I want to say from here, in the arrow logic, phi is provable if and only if the algebraic term corresponds to phi is 1. Actually, in RA, I'm sorry. Okay, that this equation should be valid in RA. Here I should write rel, doesn't matter. So, and this is the way how I know, I'm sorry, this is the only example which I can give. Maybe there are better examples. And then if you consider the free algebra of RA generated by M, and then assume that A is an atom in this free algebra. What does it mean it is an atom in this free algebra? It means that it is below any element or its negation. Right? So A is an atom if A is less than X or not X for every X. Right? Which means that in the corresponding form of logic, it will prove, okay, just make it omega in order to get rid of this question. Okay? Which means that A can prove. So this, if this is algebraic terms, come here to phi, which means that the corresponding formula to A can prove any other formula or its negation. Right? Did you understand? That's great. Okay. I can't give an example, so it's hard to give an example. So I just give you some intuition. So probably you all know something about Godel incompleteness property and how Godel proved his incompleteness property, and the idea that he tried to enumerate the mathematics, right? Or first order logic, right? And probably you all saw somehow how he enumerated the logic, that he gave numbers for the variables, and then he gave numbers for the connectives, and such on, and so on. And then for any formula, how from the variables, how I can give the number which corresponds to this formula, and then for any proof, how can I give a number which corresponds to these proofs, right? And this enumeration, this is recursive enumeration. So the good example for recursive enumeration is what Godel did. Whether it is not, but it's okay. Right? And then Godel just showed that using this enumeration, what he did, he constructed a formula which is speaking about itself and saying that I am not provable. Right? This is what Godel did, in fact. So Godel constructed a formula such that if you make any extension to this formula, there will be another formula which is not provable and its negation is not provable. Is it clear now? And this is just an extension of what Godel did, but in general way for any logic. Nothing else. Is it okay? You are the only person who is supporting me. Thank you. Okay, so I forgot where I was. Yeah. So if I want to speak about, I hope that this was enough for defining Godel incompleteness property and weak Godel incompleteness property. I'm not sure. Okay. I don't know why you don't want to believe that a recursive extension, I mean a recursive extension, it means an extension which is enumerable using recursive function. Just say enumerable extension. Just countable extension. Is this hard? Just a countable extension. This is hard? Okay, that's all. Okay. Consider like it is countable extension. This is a recursive extension. Assume like this. And then for any extension, you can find the formula which is not provable from this extension, and its negation is not provable from this extension. Is it okay now? Hopefully. Okay, and then let me continue. And then I wanted to define what does it mean arrow logic. So if I want to speak about arrows, I need a language, right? First, I need a language. And the language should be an infinite set of atomic propositions, right? And then some connectives, which is the Boolean ones, and some modal ones, and constant symbol. Right? This is my language. And then the set of formulas is the smallest set, which contains B, and which is closed under those connectives, under those, which of course contains B and the constants, and which is closed under the connectives. And then the probability, I will define it later, the models, is an ordered pair such that F is in SQ and V is an evaluation. Right? We all know that a model, we need a model and evaluation to speak about validity of the formulas. And then if you want to say that a model M so we need to say that there exists A in M such that M and A validate phi. And then this is defined in the usual way for logic, that if phi is just a proposition in B, where is B? Okay, then the model validate phi if and only if A is in V of this atomic, and then and it is the intersection or it is the union and so on and composition and in the usual way. And then this probability is defined as I said, Tarski gave an axiomatization for a large part of the relations. So this probability is mainly the one which is given by Tarski. And then we define the arrow logic. And then this theorem is exactly what Tarski did, that, or what is algebraic logic, that according to the axioms or the probability system which was proposed by Tarski, phi is provable if and only if the algebraic term corresponds to phi equals to 1 in this class. It's okay? And of course, the validity, we defined the class to be the SQs, right? And also we saw that the complex algebras of SQ is just full relation set algebras, which means that any formula will be valid in this logic if and only if the corresponding algebraic term is 1 in this class of representable relation algebras. As we mentioned before, RA is only an approximation of RRA, right? Which means that they are not equal, which means that this logic is sound but not complete, because we showed that RRA is subset of RA, right? So this is the valid formulas, right? Valid formulas will be provable, and this is sound. But the other direction, Lindon said that it is not correct, which means that there is a provable formula which is not valid, right? Which means that this logic is not complete. Moreover, Tarski showed that mathematics can be built up in the equational theory of the relation algebras, RA, hence our logic, of course. So he built up the mathematics inside RA, which means that our logic is undecidable and has Godel incompleteness property, right? Mr. Henkin, relativization in algebraic logic. So if you noticed, when I was speaking about the representable algebras, in the representable algebras, usually I defined the full set algebra to be a power set of a square. Do you remember? The full relation set algebra was power set of U cross U and something, right? So it was full squares, right? Mr. Henkin said that why should I take squares? And then for this relativization, he tried to, for this representation, he tried to generalize. So relativization in algebraic logic started by Leon Henkin as a technique for generalizing representations of algebras of logic, while also in some cases diffusing undesirable or undesirable properties like undecidability. We will see about that. So I deleted. So let S denote symmetric, R denote reflexive, T denote transitive, okay? And let H be any collection of those properties, okay? Do you remember how I defined FRA? I defined it, any algebra here is power set of U cross U and some operations, right? Here, I will define FRA phi to be a power set of W, where W is only subset of U cross U. So what about the operations? I have intersection, union, complementation. I have 0, 1, identity, right? Now, the operations will be the relativized one. How can I define the relativized one? Simply, R is the usual composition, okay, in U cross U, but I will make intersection with W. This is what we call, we relativize the operations to W, that we already know the composition and the converse and such on. We define the same operations, but we restrict it on W. Is it okay? And then this is FR phi. And then FRAH is all the algebras A in FRA phi, such is that this W, we call it the unit of the algebra. So such is that the unit is H relation on the base. The base is U. And then a relation is called H relation on U if it satisfies the properties in H. So if H is just S, all what I need from F are S, only the symmetric units. If H is T, all what I need is the transitive units. If it is collection, I need the units which satisfies this collection. Is it okay? And then define the representable relation, relativized relation algebras to be here, just isomorphic copies of subalgebras of FRAH. Okay, I suppose that someone can understand what my talk. So maybe someone will ask me why here you didn't put. Okay, of course, except a few conditions, few people. Why I didn't put P here? Why there is no product here? Because when I was speaking about U cross U, if I take the product is simply the disjoint union. So if I take a square and another square and I take union of two squares, this is not square, right? But here I take a subset of a square. So if I take a subset of a square and then a subset of another square, the union of those subsets will be subset of a bigger square. So I don't need to put product here. Only what I need, subalgebra and isomorphic copies. That's very nice. Okay, thank you, Henkin. And then, Mr. Henkin, yeah. And then, the class of representable relation, the relativized representable relation algebras, is finitely axiomatizable if and only if the unit is not transitive. Or no, if I don't require the unit to be transitive. If and only if T is not in H. And the negative results are mainly due to Andreyka, except the non-finite axiomatizability of RRA when R and S and T are all in H, and this is due to Monk, and the positive results are due to Kramer and Maddox. Okay? The equational theory of RRAH is decidable if and only if T is not in H. Okay? And again, you can find the positive results and negative results. Okay? Which means that if I take T from H, if I don't require my unit to be transitive, this class is very nice because it is finitely axiomatizable, which means that the corresponding logic is complete and sound. Actually, it is strongly complete and strongly sound. Its equational theory is decidable, which means that the logic which is corresponding to this class is decidable. Right? Nice. Atomicity of the free algebras. The atomicity of some free algebras of logic was studied by Nemetti, and this topic was suggested to him by Monk. And Nemetti proved, essentially, I think, in his DSSC dissertation, but I'm not sure, that for every finite M, neither one of the free algebra generated by M generators of RA or the free algebra generated by M generators of the representable RA is atomic. Okay? This result is, he didn't, okay, how he proved it, roughly speaking, the atomicity of the relation algebras is related to Godel incompleteness property. So he took the R logic, and then he proved that this R logic has a Godel incompleteness property, which already Tarski did, and then the proof is, but Tarski just did for this, not for this, he also did. And then he translated this logic from the language of logic, this result from the language of logic to the language of algebra. So these results are not algebraic in this sense. It is just the translations from the logic, from the results in the language of logic to results in the language of just the translation from English to French. And it was an open question posed in the most recent book in algebraic logic, this book, whether the free relativized relation algebras are atomic or not. So the question is, FRM, RRAH, is atomic or not? And the atomicity of the free relativized relation algebras was studied by me. Why? By me. Yeah, Mr. Mohamed Khalid. Thank you. And, okay, what I proved, this is just the statements which I proved because I don't have enough time. So, why I put these conditions? If I put restrictions on my unit to be reflexive and the irreflexive, then it is empty, right? Then the class of these algebras will be empty. It's not interesting, right? And if I put it to be irreflexive and anti-symmetric and symmetric, again, it will be empty, right? So I cannot take three of them and I cannot take two of them, okay? So this is why I put these conditions. And also, I want to say something. Here, you noticed something. In all what I was speaking before, H was subset of R and S and T. It's understandable why I removed T, because T makes this logic not nice. It's undecidable. It's not finitely axiomatizable, right? So OK, we removed T to get a nice logic. But what is IR and what is AS? Why I put irreflexive and antisymmetric? When I put them, I just put them because I am silly mathematician. So I was angry. Why they just consider these properties? Why they don't consider the other properties? But it gave up some nice results. So first of all, if I have both symmetric and antisymmetric, and of course not irreflexivity, then this free algebra is finite. And we know that any finite Boolean algebra is atomic, which means that this will be atomic. Okay? So very nice. So if both S and AS are in my logic, it will be atomic. Nice. If AS is not there, and just I put RS or IRS, but the free algebra generated by zero generators, again, those will be finite, which means that, again, atomic. But even the zero generator, just the S, still it is not atomic. So if S is in H and it is alone, it is not atomic. But if it is with R or with IR, it is atomic. Okay? If S is not in H, but also AS is not in H, then this is not atomic for any M. Nice? If S is in H, but AS is not in H, then this is not atomic for any M greater than or equal to 1. And finally, if AS is in H, the property which I put, and the S is not in H, then those algebras are atomic for any M, which is nice. Atomicity of the free algebras has some nice, but in any case, has some nice interpretation in logic. And moreover, I proved moreover that if H is AS or IR or R, there is no S, and of course I cannot have both of them, and AS is always in H, then this class is decidable. And it has finite model property. It's not important. And then what is the decidable fragments of R logic? It's exactly, do you remember what we were doing, and do you remember SQ? Nice. Do you remember SQ? I will say SQH. If W is H relation on U, okay? Then those SQH will be the models of the fragments of the new logic. I will define a new logic with those new models, okay? And of course, as we saw before, if T is not in H, then this logic will be decidable, and this logic will be strongly sound and strongly complete. So LR, I called it like this, LREL, relations, and H is a strongly sound and strongly complete logic. And it is decidable logic for all of these cases. Those cases are not all mine. Some of them are Marx. And then when I put AS in the logic, those are my results. And then if S is in H, but AS is not in H, then this logic has what is called weak Godel incompleteness property, that any formula and any finite recursive extension, it is incomplete. And finally, if AS is in H, this logic doesn't have Godel incompleteness property. Okay? And the detail, if someone needs the draft from this result, you can ask me, and thank you.